Dr. Grenache, would you put this study into context by discussing the background issues that led to the idea for this study?
A few years ago, I was a co-author on a paper that evaluated or discussed some of the tests that we believe to be antiquated in laboratory medicine. And one of those tests that we considered to be obsolete was the Qualitative Serum Pregnancy Test. We commonly call them pregnancy tests, although they really detect the presence of a hormone that's only produced during pregnancy called human chorionic gonadotropin. And tests for HCG are usually done very rapidly in order to quickly assess a woman's pregnancy status. There are two flavors of pregnancy tests or HCG tests. They can either be done on urine samples or on serum samples. When urine is the sample of choice, the test can be performed rapidly and very close to the patient at the point of care because urine doesn't require any special processing. However, a qualitative serum pregnancy test really can't be done at the point of care. It has to be done in the laboratory, and that's because the blood sample has to be centrifuged to obtain the serum, and typically centrifugation is only done in the laboratory. So we thought that qualitative serum pregnancy tests were obsolete for really four reasons. First, they can't be performed at the point of care. Second, laboratories usually have a way to perform a quantitative serum HCG test in a relatively short amount of time as well. Third, it's conventional wisdom that qualitative HCG tests are not as analytically sensitive as the quantitative tests. And fourth, it could be argued since the only clinical use for a qualitative serum pregnancy test is to rule out or rule in pregnancy, we could argue that in that situation, the most sensitive test, the quantitative test, should be used. Unfortunately, there were no data published in the literature that helped address that question, so I decided to do a study. Our hypothesis was that physicians ordered qualitative serum pregnancy tests because they believed they got the results back from the laboratory more quickly than had they ordered a quantitative serum pregnancy test. So one objective was to compare the turnaround times for the qualitative and the quantitative serum HCG tests, and a second objective was to examine the analytical sensitivities of the two types of tests. Dr. Furtado, we hypothesized that physicians ordered qualitative serum pregnancy tests instead of quantitative serum pregnancy tests because they believed they would get the results back more quickly from the qualitative test. To help answer that question, we did a survey of physicians at the University of Utah. So could you tell me what those survey results showed?
Sure. So the survey showed that most doctors use the urine HCG test instead of serum, which was not that surprising. However, of those who used serum, half preferred to use qualitative tests instead of quantitative tests, despite the fact that they believe that quantitative tests have better accuracy. So as we suspected, the reason they prefer to use qualitative tests is because it's that impression that they receive the results more rapidly than the quantitative tests. And our data, our turnaround time data, didn't support this fact. So there are a few definitions of turnaround time. For clinicians, turnaround time is the time that it takes for them to get a result after a test has been ordered. While for laboratorians, the definition of turnaround time is the time that it takes for a result to be produced after they receive the sample in the lab. So for in the lab, if we use the laboratorians' definition of turnaround time, the qualitative tests are performed more quickly than the quantitative tests, although by the doctor's definition of turnaround time, there are no difference between the quantitative and qualitative tests. And that's because the time that it takes for a sample to make it to the lab, the sample to be transported to the lab, is one of the main factors in the delay of a total test processing. So although physicians believe that they do get results faster with the qualitative test, our data show that it doesn't seem to be the case. One of the objectives of this study was to compare the analytical sensitivity and the performance characteristics of the qualitative and quantitative serum HCG tests. How did you do that and what were your results?
in order to compare the analytical sensitivity of the qualitative test against the quantitative test, we had to have samples that for which the qualitative serum test had been ordered. And that was easy. We took samples that came to the laboratory for which a physician had ordered a qualitative serum pregnancy test, and we simply measured the concentration of HCG using our quantitative assay. Now, the cutoff for the qualitative test, as claimed by the manufacturer for the device that we used, was 25 IUs per liter, meaning that a serum sample with an HCG concentration that was greater than 25 should yield a positive result, and technically one that was less than 25 should yield a negative result. But we know that that a cutoff isn't always absolute. And we were curious to know if the qualitative test was able to detect HCG at a concentration that was really lower than the cutoff. And actually, that's what we did find. About 20% of the samples that were interpreted as positive by the qualitative test actually had an HCG concentration that was less than 25, indicating that the qualitative test that we used was actually more analytically sensitive than it was claimed by the manufacturer. And that's a good thing. Determining the performance characteristics of the qualitative test was a little bit more challenging, because the performance characteristics are going to be based upon what you compare it to, what we would call the gold standard. And so we had to think about what gold standard we would use to compare the qualitative test against. And we decided to use multiple criteria, multiple gold standards. For example, when we did chart review on the patient samples to determine actual pregnancy status, which makes sense. This is a test that's being used to identify pregnancy or not. So when we compared the performance of the qualitative test against actual pregnancy status, we found that the qualitative test devices performed as well as the quantitative tests, meaning that they were both very sensitive and specific. That means that there were very few false positive or false negative results. A particular performance characteristic that's very important is the negative predictive value. That is, if a result is interpreted as negative, how reliable is it? The negative predictive value of both the qualitative and the quantitative tests when compared against the actual pregnancy status was 99.9%. That tells us that a negative result from the qualitative test is very believable and rules out the possibility of pregnancy. I think it's important for laboratories to understand possible causes of false positive and false negative HCG test results. Could you explain those?
So first, it's important to determine what a false result really is, because although we see the HCG tests as pregnancy tests, they really aren't. They're tests that are designed to detect and measure HCG. And there are occasions in other than pregnancy in which HCG can be present and measured by the devices that are used for test. For example, if a pregnancy is spontaneously lost very early after fertilization, that's the so-called biochemical pregnancy, if an HCG test is performed at that time, it's going to detect HCG. And while that can be considered a false positive result for a pregnancy, that really isn't a false positive result in terms of measuring HCG. Another conditions in which HCG can be present without, in the absence of a pregnancy, is in certain types of tumors, such as those derived from placental trophoblastic tissue or some germ cell tumors, in which HCG can also be elevated. And there is also the pituitary gland that can produce HCG, especially in those women who have gone through menopause. And there are also the issue of exogenous HCG that can be used for fertility treatments or in the HCG diet. And all of these different situations in which HCG is produced, if we test with the HCG test device, we will detect HCG despite of pregnancy.
So you've told us how HCG tests could be positive in the absence of pregnancy, but they're positive because HCG is actually present. Are there any situations in which you could get a positive HCG test, yet HCG is not present?
Yes, and in fact, there are two main reasons why we can have a true false positive results with the HCG testing. And one of them is the presence of an interfering antibody in the patient's sample that can mimic HCG. This happens more commonly when we are testing serum rather than urine, because those antibodies, they're not present in urine. Another situation is when an HCG test device is misinterpreted by the person who is doing the test, because those tests are actually analyzed by visual inspection, and sometimes the person who is reading the test might make mistakes and report them incorrectly.
Can you tell me about some causes of false negative HCG test results?
Yeah, so the false negative test results are not as common as the false positive results. And the most common cause is when a test is performed too early after fertilization occurs. Because in order for HCG to be produced, there is a need for the implantation of the fertilized egg, and it might take a couple of days for the HCG to reach a level in which it can be measured. It's important to note here that no laboratory test will be perfect, and the importance is that if a physician notices that there is a discrepancy between an HCG test result and a clinical presentation of the patient, to contact the laboratory so actions can be taken towards troubleshooting a potential problem. So, Dr. Grenache, based on the results of this study, should the qualitative serum HCG test be considered obsolete?
That's a good question. I think we've learned three important points from our study. First, that physicians do order qualitative serum pregnancy tests, or serum HCG tests, because they believe they can get the results back from the laboratory more quickly than if they ordered a quantitative test. What we discovered with our study was that, at least here at the University of Utah, that is not true, because the turnaround times for the qualitative and the quantitative serum HCG test were not significantly different from each other. The second thing I think we learned was that the qualitative serum HCG test has a greater or is more analytically sensitive than is claimed by the manufacturer. And the third point that we learned was that when compared against actual pregnancy status, the reason the test is being done, both the qualitative and the quantitative serum HCG test had similar performance characteristics. Particularly, they both had a negative predictive value that was 99.9%, effectively ruling out pregnancy if a negative result was obtained. So, in light of that, I'd say, yes, the qualitative serum pregnancy test could be replaced by a quantitative test, but there doesn't seem to be any compelling reason to do it.
Are there any limitations of this study?
Yes, there were a few. First, it's important to emphasize that we performed the study just here at the University of Utah. And so the turnaround time data that we collected may not apply to other healthcare systems. Secondly, I think it's important to emphasize that our study was focused on the comparison of serum qualitative and quantitative HCG tests. We didn't look at urine tests, urine qualitative HCG tests, and they're very different. And so I think it's important for people to appreciate that what we've been talking about today is in regards to serum tests and not urine HCG tests. If a laboratory is considering abandoning performing the qualitative serum HCG test, I would caution that they evaluate their turnaround time data before they do so.